Hello students, so in today's session we are going to learn the levels of protein structures. So we already discussed what do you mean by proteins and what are the structures of proteins and the classification and two types we have seen, that is fibrous proteins and globular proteins. Next one are levels of protein structures. So here there are four levels of structural organization, means how they are arranged. So basing on that, it is divided into four types: primary structure, secondary structure, tertiary structure and quaternary structure. So first one is primary structure. So primary structure of a protein, so here each protein has one or more polypeptide chains. So each polypeptide chain in a protein has amino acid linkage with each other in a specific sequence. So simply, the sequence of amino acids in polypeptide chain is held together by peptide bond only. So peptide bond only. So here you can see different types of amino acids are joined together, okay, with the help of a peptide chain. So if you see the primary structure, mostly it will be straight. Okay, mostly it will be straight. So the primary structure of a protein gives the sequence of amino acids. So change in the primary structure, if any change in this primary structure, different proteins can be formed. So this is the first one, that is primary structure. In primary structure, what is going, what did you understand? The sequence of amino acids in a polypeptide chain held together with the help of peptide bond only, no any other bonds, only peptide bond only will be present. Next one, secondary structure. So here polypeptide chain is linked by peptide bond. So here peptide bond is present as well as hydrogen bond is also present. In secondary structure, two bonds are present. What are they? In polypeptide chain is linked by peptide bond as well as hydrogen bond. Example, alpha helices and beta sheet. Okay. So look at this structure, children. So here the primary structure only, it is bent. Here two amino acids were already joined with the help of a peptide bond and cross linkage also you can see with the help of an hydrogen bonding, isn't it? The bond which is present here is hydrogen bonding. So this is one type of a secondary structure. This is another type. Here also the small are the amino acids which are again joined with the help of an hydrogen bond. This is a alpha helices. So these are the two examples for secondary structure. And tertiary structure, if we see the tertiary structure, so if we see the tertiary structure, the tertiary structure of a protein represents the overall folding of polypeptide chains. That means this folding form, okay, that is the further folding of secondary structure, means this only further folding of secondary structure will be taken place. So based on their molecular shape, proteins are of two types: protein, fibrous proteins and globular proteins, already we have discussed. So here in tertiary structures, it is a 3D globular structure formed by interaction between R group. R group means what, children? Here side chain, isn't it? So the linkage between this side chain and the amino acid, the main forces which are going to be act to stabilize the secondary and tertiary structures are, so look at here, salt bridges or ionic interaction will be present between the bonds. We already discussed how deuterions are formed, no? That means dipolar ions are already present. So the interaction between that bonds and disulfide bonds, okay, disulfide bonds, van der Waal forces. So here also see, COO minus and NH3 plus ions are there. With the help of this ion, the strong bond will be formed. Next, hydrogen bonding and electrostatic forces of attraction. So this all things will act upon this tertiary structure. So this type of a folding, okay, the extent of a folding depends on mainly ionic bonds, hydrogen bond, disulfide linkage and hydrogen bonding, electrostatic forces of attraction. So basing on that, the structure you are going to get is this. So this is about tertiary structure. And quaternary structure, same, all these forces also act on this. So here aggregation of two or more polypeptide chains into a single functional unit. So aggregation of two or more polypeptide chain into a single functional unit. That means here what is happening? Some proteins are composed of two or more polypeptide chain. So these two or more polypeptide chains are called subunits and the proteins are called oligomers. What they are called? Oligomers. So these subunits form aggregates. These subunits form aggregates. So here the spatial arrangement of subunits related to each other is known as quaternary structures. Okay, these are the four structures of amino acids associated with the shape of the proteins. So what is happening here, all the secondary and tertiary all will be combined here. So to show different form, I have taken with two types of ink. Okay, so these are the, so quaternary structure means, what did you understand? Aggregation of two or more polypeptide chains into a single functional unit. So all are acting as a single functional unit. So it does not apply to any every protein, only to the quaternary structure only. So same forces means, so whatever forces are acting in tertiary structure, all that forces will be present in quaternary structure also. So these are the four levels of structural organization. Next one is denaturation of a protein. So denaturation means removal of that nature. So here take one example of any structure, means any protein. So if you hear that, what happened, the pH will be changed. Okay, the pH will be changed, and again the structure will be, so this form of structure is changed to this form of structure, means structural deformation has taken place. Structural deformation, when it takes place, physical properties will be changed. When physical properties are changed, means biological properties also change. For example, egg is a protein. So if you boil in hot water, what happen children, the loose and the liquid like substance will be get hardened. That means there the physical and chemical properties also changing, right? So their physical and chemical properties are changing. So this is how denaturation will take place. So the breakdown of highly organized tertiary structure of a protein when it loses its biological activity is called denaturation or unfold. That means proteins are undergoing denaturation most readily at its isoelectric point. Understand, during denaturation second and tertiary structures are destroyed, but primary structure will not destroy. Remember that primary structure cannot be destroyed. Okay, denaturation will not take place for primary structure, only secondary and tertiary structures only it will be taken place. So what are the things are responsible for this denaturation is change in pH level. When change in pH, which breaks down the hydrogen bonds and electrostatic force of attraction which are acting in it. And next, adding of detergents which can break down the normal hydrophobic interaction among the nonpolar groups. So when you add any detergent and all that, hydrogen bond means nonpolar groups and hydrophobic interaction will be destroyed. And adding some reagents like urea forms stronger hydrogen bonds with the proteins than the hydrogen bonds present between the groups. And the next one is heating. Heating also can affect the proteins. Okay, heating also, so which can break down the attractive forces which are present in proteins. So this is called denaturation of proteins. So normal, if you take any protein, by heating the pH change, by the pH level will be changed, then structural deformation will take place. When structural deformation is takes place, their physical and chemical properties are also going to be changed. Next comes to topic, means here example children, for denaturation, curdling of milk also, the milk when change to curd, that also some denaturation will take place, denaturation of proteins. And next topic is vitamins. Okay, vitamins are the organic compounds required in our diet in very small amount. Small amount is enough to perform our specific biological functions. So here the vitamins, so what did you understand? Vitamins are required in very small quantity, isn't it? Vitamins are required to our body in very small quantity. So in our diet, if we do not take that vitamins, what happened? Deficiency diseases are going to be caused. So their deficiency causes specific diseases. And the next one, plants can synthesize almost all of them. So they are considered as essential food factors. And the bacteria which is present in our gut can produce some of the vitamins required by our body. So whatever bacteria which is present in our gut, means in stomach, they can what they will do? They can produce some of the vitamins required by our body. So that means, what did you understand? Animals can synthesize few of the vitamins, but not all vitamins. So human body can synthesize vitamin A from carotene. Some members of vitamins and link B complex and vitamin K are synthesized by microorganisms present in our intestinal tract of human beings. Okay, intestinal tract of human beings. That means B complex, vitamins and vitamin K can be synthesized by the microorganisms present in our intestinal tract. And the remaining vitamins are to be taken through our food, like proteins, vitamins also, some of the vitamins we have to take through our diet. So here the term vitamin was introduced by Funk, F-U-N-K. Okay. So vitamins are essential dietary factors. So vitamins are not utilized in cell building or as energy sources, but it can be act as a catalyst. So what? Vitamins can be act as a catalyst in our biological process. So catalyst in our biological process. So here vitamins are not utilized in cell building like proteins or as energy sources, but they can act as a catalyst in our biological process. So the deficiency causes serious diseases known as deficiency of these vitamins or vitamins causes what they causes? They causes serious diseases known as avitaminosis. Understand, avitaminosis, because of this, we have to take, the growing children should require a lot of vitamins, and the pregnant woman who is going to give a birth to a baby also required to take a lot of vitamins. Vitamins are partly destroyed and partly excreted. So vitamins can be stored in our body, in the body to some extent only. For example, the fat soluble vitamins are stored in the liver. Fat soluble vitamins. Okay, fat soluble vitamins are stored. Where it is stored? In the liver. Okay, fat soluble vitamins are stored in the liver. Okay. And vitamins can perform their work in very small quantities, and the total daily requirement of vitamins are very less. So we are required to take very less amount of vitamins. And next comes to classification. The term vitamin was coined from the word. The term vitamin was coined from the word vital plus amine. Okay, vital plus amine. Vital means important and amine means amino group. So later some of the work showed that most of them do not contain amino group. So what happened? We have removed the letter E and it has become vitamin. Okay, vitamin. So we nowadays we are using the word vitamin, not vitamine. Okay, vitamine. Now we are using the word vitamin. So vitamins are classified into two groups depending on their solubility. Basing on their solubility in water and fat. So first one is fat soluble vitamins. What is the first one? Fat soluble vitamins. So the vitamins which are soluble in fat and oils but insoluble in water belongs to this group. Understand, children? So here the vitamins. So what are fat soluble? Okay, by name itself you can understand the vitamins which can soluble only in fat. Okay, vitamins which are soluble in fat and oils but not in water belongs to the group fat soluble vitamins. So here example A, D, E, K, vitamins A, D, E and K. Okay. Vitamins A, D and E, K. So these are the examples for fat soluble vitamins. They are stored in the liver and adipose tissue. So where they are stored? They are stored in the liver and adipose tissue. And next comes to second one, water soluble vitamins. Water soluble vitamins. So what do you mean by water soluble vitamins? B group vitamins and vitamin C are soluble in water, so they are grouped in water soluble vitamins. Water soluble vitamins must be supplied regularly in the diet because they are readily excreted in urine and cannot be stored in our body. And so children, so here, so what are water soluble vitamins? Vitamin B group, okay, vitamin B group and vitamin C. Vitamin C are soluble in water. So when they are soluble in water, they can be readily excreted in our urine. So that, and that too, they are not stored in our body. So that is why we have to take regularly, isn't it? So we have, in through diet, we have to take them regularly. So now we are going to see some of the classification of vitamins and their deficiency disease and their chief sources. So where they are present in a tabular form. Yeah. So look at here, children. Water soluble vitamins and fat soluble vitamins. So here, water soluble vitamins, vitamin B, okay, what I said, water soluble vitamins, B group vitamins. So here B1, B2, B6, B12 and vitamin C. So B1, which is also called thiamine, and vitamin B2, vitamin B6 is also called pyridoxine, and vitamin B12 and vitamin C, which is also called ascorbic acid. So what are the chief sources where they are present is vitamin B1, thiamine is present in yeast, milk, green vegetables and cereals. So if they are not present in our diet, their deficiency causes some diseases like beriberi. Okay, beriberi. Beriberi means what? Loss of appetite. Appetite means we cannot feel much hunger. And next, retard growth. The growth is not up to the mark. So growth, stunt growth, we can see. Next one, vitamin B2. So vitamin B2 is present in milk, egg white and liver, kidney. Okay. So here, so look at here. Vitamin B2 deficiency cause chelosis, that is fissuring at corners of mouth and lips. Okay. And next one, digestive disorders and burning sensation of the skin. So these are the some of the disease we are going to get due to the lack of vitamin B2 in our body. Next, vitamin B6, pyridoxine, which is present in yeast, milk, egg yolk, cereals and grams. Okay, these diseases means the disease deficiency disease what we are going to get is convulsions. Here, burning sensation is nothing but burning sensation of the skin we are going to get. And next one is vitamin B12, which is present in meat, fish, egg and curd. Okay, so if this lack in our body, in our diet, what happens here? It causes RBC deficiency in hemoglobin, okay, anemia, perniosis, anemia, that means RBC deficient in hemoglobin. Next one, vitamin C, which is also called ascorbic acid, which is present in all citrus fruits, amla and green leafy vegetables. Okay, so this deficiency cause scurvy. Scurvy means bleeding gums. So these are the water soluble vitamins. These all are water soluble vitamins. These are the name B1, B2, B6, B12 and their sources. And here vitamin C also, and their deficiency diseases. So table will be important. Next, fat soluble vitamins. Fat soluble vitamins are vitamin A, D, E, K. If we see vitamin A, the chief sources are, where they are present are, fish, liver oil, carrots, butter and milk. So the deficiency of this vitamin A causes xerophthalmia, that means hardening of cornea of eye. That means night blindness you are going to get. We are going to get due to vitamin A deficiency is night blindness and hardening of cornea of eye also. This is one and this is one. Vitamin D, which can be present in exposure to sunlight. So early morning, okay, if you expose to sunlight, we will get vitamin D. And fish and egg yolk also it is present. And due to this lack of this vitamin D, what you are going to get, the deficiency diseases are rickets. Rickets means bone deformation in children. Okay, that means soft, the bone will be becomes very soft, and joint pains in adults you are going to see. These are the main rickets. Okay, rickets are the deficiency disease caused by vitamin D deficiency. Whenever diet do not contain this vitamin D, this type of diseases we are going to get. Next, vitamin E, which is present in vegetable oils like wheat germ oil, sunflower oil, etc. So here the deficiency disease we will get is increased fragility of RBCs and muscular weakness and increased fragility of RBCs. Okay, fragile means very weak. And vitamin K is present in all green leafy vegetables. So if the deficiency of vitamin A causes increased blood clotting time, for example when we fell down, we will see some bleeding on our body, isn't it? So if the person is lack of vitamin K, the bleeding will not stop at short time, it takes lot of time. The clotting will not take place at right time. That means what happens, more and more loss of blood we will see. So when the person is available with good vitamin K in his body, so this problem he can be avoid. So these are the some types of water soluble vitamins and fat soluble vitamins. So we have completed proteins and vitamins. In the next class we are going to see nucleic acid. Thank you, children.